Hello, everybody. Welcome to the webinar. We're waiting for 1 second more until we have our participants on the line. Thank you for joining us. We will start in a few seconds. As you can see, we have lots of people joining. So we just want to make sure that everybody has a chance to be with us before we kick it off. Okay. Welcome. It is really a pleasure to be here. My name is Carmen Burbano. I am the director of the World Food Program's School-Based Programs Division, and I'm happy to be your moderator today. You won't be hearing from me a lot, thankfully. We have a lot of topics to cover today. Very excited to be here. This is a session on the school feeding programs in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic in Asia and the Pacific. And thank you very much for joining the session. I want to start by thanking socialprotection.org for hosting this webinar, very important partnership that WFP has. And we know that today we have an audience that's very diverse. We know that we have governments and academia and development partners listening to us today. We're very happy that this topic is so important for you. The crux of this webinar is really the findings of a study that the World Food Program and Oxford Policy Management have done on the insights on what happened during the pandemic, school closures, and the impact on children, and especially the provision of school meals to those children. We're very excited to learn a little bit about the insights of what governments did, what development partners did to provide alternative measures and make sure that children were being assisted and covered even while they were at home. Let me start by just telling you a little bit about how the agenda looks like. Our opening remarks will be done by John Aylieff, our regional director in the Asia region for the World Food Program. And then colleagues from Oxford Policy Management will present the findings of the report for you. After that, I will be moderating a panel of three speakers from the Philippines, Sri Lanka, and the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. And after that, we will have time for your questions and a bit of an interactive session with our speakers. There will be this Q&A, as I mentioned. As participants are at the moment in listen-only mode. That's how we will manage this session. If you have a question, you can click on the Q&A button that you have at the bottom of your screen, and that will enable you to send a question that I will then see. We will try to answer as many questions as we can, but as you know with these things, we never know. You might be very curious and we will have to moderate time a little bit, but we are very much looking forward to the discussion. So now before we go any further, I just wanna introduce our first speaker and officially to open this webinar to Regional Director for Asia, John Aylieff. And you have there his very extensive biography. He has a 25-year experience with the World Food Program, through which he has held a number of management and senior leadership positions. I'm really happy to have John open this event. Over to you, Regional Director.
Thank you so much, Carmen, and it's really a pleasure to be here to welcome you all to this webinar on school feeding programs amidst the COVID-19 pandemic in Asia and the Pacific. I extend my sincere thanks to our moderator, Carmen Burbano, to Maham Farhat of Oxford Policy Management, and to the other distinguished panelists who join us here today. But most of all, I extend my thanks to you all for joining us for what I know will be a very exciting and stimulating discussion today. Before the COVID-19 pandemic, school feeding was the largest and most widespread social safety net in the entire world. By early 2020, school meals were reaching more children in more countries than at any time in human history. Looking at the Asia-Pacific region alone, nearly 129 million children were receiving a meal in school every day, the vast majority through programs led by visionary governments. Governments who model the political will, the strong commitment, and the ownership that these national programs require. governments who recognize the child health and nutrition benefits which these programs bring to their nations. Governments who see school feeding as an integral part of their social protection systems. WFP is very proud to have been the key partner across the globe of governments running national school feeding programs. In some countries, as you may know, WFP fosters access to school meals through direct feeding in schools. But in an increasing number of countries, much more importantly, in fact, WFP supports policy development, provides technical guidance, and helps build national capacity. Unfortunately, and this will be no surprise to you, COVID-19 has derailed a decade of growth in school meals programs. Over 300 million children in pre-primary and primary education in the Asia-Pacific region alone have had their education interrupted due to the pandemic, with huge implications for students' learning, health, and nutrition. As we know, it's at school that children, especially the most vulnerable, get vital nutrition and health support, which allows them to grow and to learn. And for children who miss out on school due to school closures, the negative effects could well last for their entire lifetime. Globally, it's also estimated that COVID-19 learning losses could result in approximately $10 trillion of earnings being lost for this generation of children. This amounts to 1/10 of global GDP. So it's vitally important then that we understand just how COVID has impacted the policy, the design, the implementation, and the monitoring of school feeding programs. And it's important that we understand that because we need to build back better. It's for this reason that WFP entered into a partnership with development consulting firm Oxford Policy Management, or OPM. We're so glad, so delighted today to have OPM with us to present the findings of this important and very timely study. We look forward very much to hearing from our speakers on what this means for them, but really what it means for us all. We also look forward to hearing much more about the Global School Meals Coalition, which is forming and gaining immense pace across the world. Supported by WFP, the coalition will catalyze actions and share knowledge, serving as a key driver of pandemic recovery and helping us to take that very much needed decisive step further towards the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. Carmen and other participants in today's webinar will tell you more about this exciting new coalition, which is really going to change the landscape for us. Excellences, distinguished participants, dear colleagues, WFP really hopes that these findings will resonate with all of you. We hope they'll be used to support the re-establishment of school feeding programs across the region. In our view, it is perhaps more important than ever that we meet the needs of those furthest behind and support them to recover from the multiple nefarious impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. School feeding will be a critical and important means of doing just that. Thank you so much for listening to these opening remarks. Welcome to all of you, and I wish you a very productive discussion. Thank you, Carmen. I hand back the floor to you.
Thank you very much, John, for those opening words. And before we go into the first session, which is the presentation of the study that WFP and OPM conducted to understand the impact of COVID on the children in the region of Asia Pacific. Let me just take a step back. And as John mentioned, we realized in 2020, I think the world realized that when schools were closed, children all over the world suffered. They suffered because they didn't have access to schools and because during school and in the school setting, they receive a lot of services. They are protected. They receive school health and nutrition programs, school meal programs, and different kinds of support systems for families. Once those safety nets were gone, we saw around the world, a majority of countries mobilized very quickly to put in place mitigation measures, coping mechanisms to make sure that children were well looked after. And at the end of 2020, this really became a very important discussion globally. What happens when these safety nets are gone? What can we do in 2021 to reestablish them as a matter of priority? And so the Global School Meals Coalition was born in February of this year that idea took off, thanks to the leadership of many government leaders that really got together and said, we need to do something about this. That's what we've been working on at the context of the Food Systems Summit. Some of you may be aware of this. At the end of 2021, in September, the Secretary General of the United Nations will be hosting a very important meeting to understand what can we jointly do to make our food systems more sustainable and more nutritious and affordable for all. In the context of that conversation, many governments have gotten together to say school meals programs should be considered one of the game-changing interventions that will not only help to assist our children, make sure that they're coming to school, especially girls, making sure that they have the education and the health and their nutrition covered, but also supporting smallholder farmers, markets, value chains, and providing employment and livelihood opportunities. So this is really a transformative platform that can help many sectors achieve their goals. It can also take us back on the road to achievement of the SDGs, and finally, a springboard out of this pandemic crisis. But we really see this as a transformative coalition. It is led by governments and government leaders that have decided that this is decisively one of the most important priorities of the next decade. And we are very happy to report we now have 40 plus governments that have joined or in the process of joining. And we're looking forward to the launch, which will happen in September. But before we do that, of course, this topic and this webinar is really about understanding why is that coalition so important? Why do we need to work together now to ensure that children get the support they need? And to do that, this study that was done and commissioned by WFP is a really important way of understanding the impact of the pandemic and what can we do to support governments and children and communities and their families. So let me introduce now Ms. Maham Farhat from Oxford Policy Management. She will be telling us a little bit about this really important study. And you can see there, again, a really impressive biography from her side. She is a consultant on poverty and social protection at Oxford Policy Management and has several years of working with WFP and other partners on focusing on social protection systems, delivery management, et cetera. She has provided technical support to evaluations on in several countries, including Kenya, Uganda, Somalia, Nepal, Mongolia. So you can see we have a really important and credible partner that will tell us a little bit about what this study is telling us and what can we learn. Let's hear from Maham now. Over to you.
Hi, everyone. Let me just put this on. Great. Thanks for the introduction, Carmen. And good morning and good afternoon to everyone who is listening into this webinar. I'm going to present results of a multi-country study the OPM conducted for WFP on school feeding in the aftermath of COVID-19. So the main purpose of this study was to understand how COVID-19 impacted policy design and implementation of school feeding programs in the Asia-Pacific region. And we focused on countries in the region where WFP had a presence, and more specifically, WFP's Regional Bureau of Bangkok, which at the time was overseeing work in 13 countries in the region. And the data collection and analysis for this study was basically split into two phases, with the first phase of work being done between August 2020 and November 2020, where we wanted to really understand how school feeding programs were adapted in the sort of initial response to COVID-19 when schools were closed. And then following on in the second phase of work, which was from October of last year, this should be October 2020, to May of this year. We focused on the reopening of schools and really what was the future of on-site school feeding as the pandemic unfolds. In order to inform this study, we conducted in-depth document and literature reviews And we conducted over 105 key informant interviews with stakeholders, such as WFP country office staff, implementing partners, government counterparts in ministries of education, ministries of social welfare and agriculture as well, as well as development partners and NGOs, both at the national level, as well as at the regional level. Now we selected six countries as a way to collect data and do in-depth data collection. We basically did in-depth research in six countries in the first phase. So that's Nepal, India, Philippines, Sri Lanka, Cambodia, and Bangladesh. And then in the second phase of research, we selected four out of these six countries. So Nepal, India, Philippines, and Sri Lanka. As I should emphasize that this was not an evaluation, this was really a study that was being done to understand how responses to COVID-19, school feeding responses to COVID-19 were operationalized. There were limitations to this study, especially because we were doing this in a very, very volatile policy environment. There were continuous changes to the in-country contexts. You know, the COVID-19 transmission rates varied massively. There were ongoing school closures and school reopenings. So doing research in the middle of a pandemic meant that there were challenges. So we had, for instance, team members who fell ill. We had relatively sometimes less time with partners when we were doing interviews because they were busy with COVID response. Because of the challenges with not being able to travel internationally and not being able to travel to the field in person, I think the biggest limitation was that we were unable to speak to the core beneficiaries of school feeding programs, which are school-age children. However, given all of these limitations, we did try to make sure that we validated our information by triangulating the data we were getting and speaking to multiple stakeholders. And we hope that the findings of this study, although they might not be statistically representative for all the countries, but they do illustrate some sort of core lessons learned from across the key countries in the region. Before I go on to how school feeding reacted or was adapted in the aftermath of COVID-19, I want to take a step back and explain what the context was before the pandemic started. So before the pandemic started, school feeding programs, as John pointed out, there were a number of countries implementing school feeding programs in the region. In some countries, these programs were universal for children enrolled in public primary schools, such as India, Sri Lanka. In other countries, these programs were targeted, for instance, for children who were either in very extremely food insecure areas or children who are wasted, such as in the Philippines. So that's wasted as in nutritionally wasted. Then the meals themselves, in most countries, it was hot school meals that were being provided either as a midday meal or as breakfast. In some countries, such as Bangladesh, micronutrient fortified biscuits were being provided. In other countries, the hot meals were supplemented in some schools with milk. So that would be in Sri Lanka and Philippines, for example. In a small number of countries, with the support of WFP, often governments have started to pilot homegrown school feeding programs. And so these are programs where the commodities that are supplied come from small-scale farmers who are based locally. The coverage of these programs also varied greatly. So we had, in countries such as Sri Lanka, for example, the programs cover up to 56% of primary school age children. In Cambodia, I think the estimate is around 15% of primary school age children. Across these countries, school feeding programs were seen by policymakers to address a range of objectives. So in some countries, it was seen to address short-term hunger. In other countries, they were acting as safety nets during crises. And in other countries, they were there to incentivize school enrollment, attendance, and retention. And as Carmen mentioned before, There are a range of complementary services that are often provided alongside school meeting or school feeding programs in schools. And this includes things like micronutrient supplementation, deworming, menstrual hygiene management. And a lot of these interventions were often provided alongside school feeding, but usually as standalone services. In limited cases, under certain programs, they were being provided as an integrated package, but mostly as sort of standalone parallel services. And WFP's role in the region also varied depending on the country context. So in some countries, such as Bangladesh, Cambodia, and Nepal, WFP was focused very much on aiding scale up of school feeding programs and transitioning school feeding programs from being supported by WFP to being led and to being implemented and led by governments. In other countries where the programs were very much led and financed by governments, WFP was providing technical assistance, advocacy, and support on innovation. Now, when prior to COVID-19, there were an estimated 129 million children who were receiving school meals in the RBB region, and that by RBB region, I mean around 13 countries in the Asia-Pacific region. And of those, most of the children were supported by programs which are led by governments. By the end of March 2020, most countries had closed schools. And so vast numbers of children were therefore no longer receiving school meals. And after the school closures, there were efforts made by countries across the board to first adapt learning and introduce a mix of either in-person learning or remote teaching. And so schools were closed, and this was really an unprecedented time in terms of school closures globally. When I refer to school closures, I adopt the definition that is sort of adopted by UNESCO in saying that we consider schools to be fully reopened when classes are held in person for all school children and at all grade levels. So the COVID-19 had this massive disruption to education, and as a result, on-site school feeding programs also stopped. In response to that, almost across the board, school feeding programs were adapted to varying degrees in the sample countries. I will pick a few examples that you can see on the screen. So in India, there's a large government-led school feeding program called the Midday Meal Program, which targets children enrolled in public primary schools. And this program is underpinned by legislation. And the legislation also mandates the states in India to adapt the program and provide a food security allowance in case they cannot provide meals in school. And that legislation really meant that states had to respond to school closures and therefore had to provide a food security allowance, either in the form of food grains or in the form of money to cover cooking costs associated with school feeding. And so therefore the program was adapted. And it's also worth pointing out that in India, prior to the pandemic, only children who were attending classes regularly were getting school meal programs. But this attendance condition was waived in the aftermath of the pandemic. And so then all children who were essentially enrolled in public primary schools received the food security allowance. Another example is Nepal. So in Nepal, prior to the pandemic, school feeding programs were operating in around 34 districts out of 77 districts in the country. And a large expansion was done of the school feeding programs, a school feeding program by the government. When the pandemic started, school feeding was not adapted throughout all the 34 districts. It was only adapted in seven of the most food insecure districts where a food for education project, which is supported by WFP, is operating. And the adaptations included take-home rations of rice, lentils, and oil. But the vast majority of schools, unfortunately, did not receive a take-home ration. Final example that I wanted to highlight was the Philippines, where prior to the pandemic, school feeding in the national program outside of the Barm region was providing hot meals and milk in selected schools to children who are severely wasted. In the aftermath of the pandemic, the program was adapted. It was adapted towards the end of the year, so it came a little bit late. But the take-home ration basically comprised of an enhanced nutri bun and milk. And this was distributed with the support of community members and teachers. Rice was not provided because there were other social protection programs which were distributing rice. In the Barm region within the Philippines, which is the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region, where the program is implemented somewhat differently from the national program, hot meals were provided prior to the pandemic, but in the aftermath of the pandemic, there were efforts to adapt the program and provide take-home rations consisting of a number of commodities, but this was unfortunately delayed and could not be done in 2020 due to challenges in procurement and operational challenges. So overall, in all the six countries where we worked, we saw that the from hot in-school meals, school feeding programs were adapted into take-home rations, often providing commodities such as rice and oil. These take-home rations were incredibly helpful. They helped reduce food insecurity and hunger, and they were largely timely. However, they were not perfect substitutes for a nutritionally balanced school meal. And one of the key challenges that was faced across the board was the dilution of the support that was given, in the sense that there was intra-household sharing of these commodities. So if the take-home ration, for instance, was intended to last for 20 days, it actually lasted for just 7 days or 10 days. Because the meals were, the food was being used by all members of the household and not just the children. And as with other social protection programs, such as cash transfers that were adapted in response to COVID-19, the adaptations to school feeding also relied very much on existing procurement systems, existing delivery systems, and existing identification and communication systems. So this, what this means essentially is that the strength of the system prior to the pandemic affected the way then it was adapted later on. As with the regular on-site school feeding programs, which do not include children in low-cost private schools, which are very prevalent in South Asia, and also do not include children who are out of school, these adaptations similarly did not cover these children. So we also tried to understand what were the impact of suspensions to school feeding on children. And we found that there was no direct, very difficult to disentangle the impact of school feeding suspension versus school closures per se on child level outcomes. But we can, with the evidence that we see of school closures on child level outcomes and the evidence we have from previous years of school feeding on child outcomes, we know that the overall impact of school feeding suspensions was overwhelmingly negative, both on education outcomes and children's health and well-being, as well as on protection outcomes. I see we're running out of time, so I will not delve into the details, but all the emerging evidence suggests that school closures have created very, very significant, has created significant learning loss amongst children. We also see that there are increased risks of overweight and obesity, especially in Southeast Asia, where children staying at home and learning at home are increasingly eating processed foods and leading a sedentary lifestyle. There's increase in anxiety and stress amongst children at school. And it's of course worth pointing out routine services such as vaccinations and nutrition interventions are also were also suspended during this time. And so their suspension has led to negative impacts on children. So we try to understand how policymakers and development partners were planning around these repeated school closures. I mean, there's a consensus across the board that schools need to reopen, and this is really, really a priority for all countries. But it is not clear when schools should reopen. There are no clear approaches towards anticipating when schools would be closed and what are the risks of opening schools. And so these are really quite difficult decisions for governments. At the moment, as things stand, the policies that pertain to school feeding, the planning and budgeting for school feeding, it continues to assume that the schools will open soon. It is very difficult to pin down a timeline for when exactly schools will reopen. And the same applies to programming for a lot of development partners, including WFP, where country offices are sort of doing programming on the assumption that schools will reopen soon. What we see, however, quite worryingly, is that in the region, vaccination rates are really low. And we've seen in the last few months repeated surges of the COVID-19 and repeated school closures. I mean, at the time of writing this report, this is May, in May, the country, in our sample countries, the country with the largest share of vaccinated people was Cambodia, and that's around 7% of the population had both vaccines. So this is quite concerning. And the lack of clarity on when schools will reopen and when education will resume is very, very concerning, and therefore affects planning and programming for regular school feeding. There was a lot of effort made across the board to develop school reopening frameworks with the support of UN agencies and development partners, including WFP, UNICEF, and UNESCO. And these school frameworks were really helpful in laying out the principles that should be adopted for safe reopening of schools and safe resumption of school meal programs. However, there are challenges of actually operationalizing these school reopening frameworks. One of the key challenges is poor local level capacity. So often the decision to reopen schools relies and assessing the risk of that lies with local governments who have poor capacity to assess risks and then to reopen schools in a safe manner. There's also a great deal of complexity in the mandates of local governments versus central governments, where policy to for example, impose quarantines might be taken centrally, but the decision to reopen schools might be something that's given to local governments. More importantly, a lot of these school reopening frameworks and checklists didn't account for a situation where there would be repeated school closures, and therefore school feeding would need to switch off and switch on. We also, for example, saw in one country that, with respect to challenges of implementing school reopening frameworks, the local government officials couldn't download the school reopening framework that was developed by the central government and was uploaded on the website. So these are all challenges that we see emerging when it comes to the actual operationalization of school reopening frameworks. We also took a quick look at school feeding budgets. And in all the countries which have released a school feeding budget so far, and the fiscal years vary, so we haven't seen all the budget figures for 2021 yet, but we see there's results for cautious optimism. In most countries, the budgets have been either maintained, so that would be in the Philippines and in India, school feeding budgets have been maintained. In Sri Lanka, school feeding budget for next year has increased. So that's very good news, but we know that there are risks to cuts in education sector budgets, especially in the long run. And this is based on some of the work that's been done by, for instance, the Education Finance Watch report that came out earlier in the year. We also know that there will be a much greater need for school feeding financing in the future, especially as we see closures of low-cost private schools and therefore move increase in enrollments from private sector to the public sector. We also know that the coverage needs to expand because governments have committed already to taking over school feeding financing from development partners. So in the future, we expect that the need for school feeding financing would increase, but the risk to cuts for school feeding budgets are quite high. We wanted to understand what this all meant, the sort of new education context and the policy challenges. What did they mean for organizations like WFP who advocate for school feeding? And it's really important to point out that the advocacy efforts are very closely linked to the evidence of the impact of on-site school feeding on child-level outcomes. So really, the global consensus now is that instead of focusing on just the first 1,000 days of a child's life, we should focus on the first 8,000 days of children's life, and that basically what children eat and how they are cared for in these first 8,000 days determine their long-term life outcomes. And in order to gather robust evidence on this link, we need school feeding to operate, and we need on-site school feeding to operate. So in some ways, the advocacy for the future of school feeding depends really on the safe reopening of schools. What we saw very encouragingly was that globally, the coordination and cooperation amongst development partners has improved. I mean, really prompted by the really drastic school closures and the dramatic impacts that they have on children. We saw this joint call for reopening of schools back in 2020, which was led by the Global Education Coalition. As was mentioned by Carmen, WFP has launched this year the Global School Meals Coalition, which aims at increasing advocacy and research, and also encouraging governments to increase financing for school feeding. At the same time, based on our research on the ground, we think that there are, at the national level, there are gaps when it comes to coordination and cooperation, not just amongst development partners, but also amongst governments, both across sort of horizontally across line agencies, and also vertically between central level governments and local level governments. And the challenge is really in approaching school feeding and looking at it as a multi-sectoral intervention, because school feeding is not just about food security, but it is really part of the wider social protection, health, and education systems. And that is an area where there are still a lot of challenges in practical terms in how partners and line ministries coordinate. And school feeding is often seen as sort of a standalone food security intervention, whereas really it should be seen as an integrated school health and nutrition program.
We're running really over time now, so yes. I think we're going to have to wrap up.
Yeah. Should I go through the recommendations quickly, or should I skip these?
Yeah, I think if you can just very quickly run us through it, maybe we have some chance again at the Q&A.
Yeah, sure. So very quickly, the core recommendations based on our work for WFP and partners supporting school feeding is that the internal programming of WFP should, and governments should really account for the risks of repeated school closures, as well as the changes brought about by the pandemic. We should no longer be in an emergency response mode, but we should really accept that the pandemic is ongoing, and therefore something needs to be done in the interim, where take-home rations need to be adjusted so that they are adequate, they are nutritionally sufficient for children, and that the messaging around them perhaps should also emphasize that they are primarily for children. WFP and partners should continue to advocate for investment in school feeding as a part of this integrated school health and nutrition package. It would also be really helpful to invest in and support systematic research on the impact of school feeding suspensions and the new challenges emerging for primary school age children, including risks to their learning as well as their health. And finally, there should be more efforts to develop a coordinated strategy and plan for safe school reopening. And that should incorporate effective measures in the event of repeated school closures. And things like the Global School Coalition isn't really an ideal platform to allow WFP and governments to do that. So thanks very much. And sorry about running over time. I will now hand back over to Carmen.
Thank you so much for that super interesting and informative report. I should say also that there is a full report. And so those of you that are curious about any of the details of what was just presented, you're welcome to check the executive summary of the report itself. And I'm sure our organizers will make that available to you if you don't have it already. Let me just move now to the second part of our event now, which is a panel interview. And I can see a lot of you in the questions are wondering, what are countries, individual countries doing? So thankfully, we have three participants. Two of them are from a country. We'll start with Brenda Barton, the World Food Program's country director in the Philippines, to tell us a little bit about two things, Brenda, as we start. What are the key lessons learned from the COVID pandemic with regards to school feeding in the Philippines? What have you seen? What do you know? Really important, I think, to also understand where is the government in all of this and what do they want to do? What WFP's role is supporting the government, but also working with partners. WFP, of course, does not work alone. And so partners like UNICEF and FAO and others are very much part of this picture. So over to you. We also have Martin Parreno, who is also a member of our country office there. I think both of you are going to walk us through a very short answer to those couple of questions. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Carmen, and all participants. I'm actually wearing two hats today in some ways, because one is from Sri Lanka, where I just completed 4.5 years. And I'm now in the Philippines where I arrived 4 months ago. So given my fresh arrival, indeed, I've asked Dr. Martin Parreno, our program policy officer, who's also our nutritionist and responsible for school meals, to give the presentation. But before I hand over to him, I did want to set the stage about the COVID situation in the Philippines. And actually this morning, I was reading a very interesting Bloomberg analysis called the COVID Resilience Ranking on the best and worst places to be as the world finally reopens. And I naturally scanned to see where was the Philippines in this listing of 53 countries. And I knew the situation here was bad, but I didn't expect to see it really at the second lowest to the bottom. So just above Argentina, 53 countries. And they had various factors, I think, that they looked at. Of course, one would have been the percentage of population that has been vaccinated. And it is indeed very low here. Only 3.2% of the population have been vaccinated. And then they had this other category that was called lockdown severity. And I feel that that's where schools and the school closures very much would have factored in. Because indeed, here in the Philippines, since March last year, the schools have not been open for in-face classes. Now, this is one of five countries in the world that has experienced that severity. And we know then, of course, that that has had a negative impact on the school meals program. So again, Martin will talk more about that. But it's also beyond that, as John was giving some estimates, we know that for every year of closure, the experts are saying that you're losing 2 years of learning. And here in the Philippines, where, you know, it is a middle-income country, there is a very stark digital divide. Less than 20% of the children in this country have access to online learning. And the majority of those are in Metro Manila. And when we talk later about the situation in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region of Muslim Mindanao, it's 4%. So indeed, you know, we're seeing other issues. We're seeing spikes in gender-based violence, domestic violence, and families. We know that call centers are receiving, hotlines are receiving more calls, and surely children, you know, who are now at home full-time are being impacted by this as well. And there was just one last stat that I thought was quite interesting about from the ADB, who've estimated that the cost of the face-to-face closures school closures is equivalent to 10% of the GDP in the Philippines. So I'll turn this over now to Martin, but I wanted to also just end by saying that President Duterte last week said that he will not allow face-to-face classes in the country until we have herd immunity. And this is a concern because experts hold little hope that this will happen before 2023. Over to you, Martin.
Thank you very much, Brenda. Allow me to share my PowerPoint here. So I have 7 slides here and I will be
Martin,
very
quick. Martin, just to let you know, you have about 5 minutes just to make sure you're managing your time.
Thank you so much, Carmen. Yeah, so pertaining to the first question, what about the lessons learned from COVID-19 here in the Philippines? So before answering that question, allow me to give some few background first about the Philippines. So it's the second most at risk for natural calamities, second fast growing economy in 2019, but because of the COVID-19, it actually went down back to slowest performance. And at the same time, this is one also of the countries in the world where stunting prevalence is very high, affecting even 25% of school-age children, and particularly in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region, mostly Mindanao, where 1 in every 2 children is already stunted. And as mentioned by our country director, it's the third highest in terms of COVID-19 problem and among the longest school closures in the world. So pertaining to the program, which we call school-based feeding program in the Philippines, it's actually an established program. It's supported by a policy. As a matter of fact, in 2019, the government promulgated a law that institutionalizes the national feeding program, but the coverage is only for children who are wasted and severely wasted. And as I mentioned in the presentation of Maham a while ago, it will only gonna cover children for about 120 days, and the objective is to really increase the classroom attendance from 85 to 100%. And this will definitely contribute to the improved health and nutrition of the children. So during the COVID-19, since the government cannot do direct intervention, what they did was to transform it and somehow customize the guidelines to make it a take-home ration for all children from kinder to grade 6. And they developed what we call the Nutriban for at least 60 days in lieu of the rice and the other food products. Apart from that, they also distributed fresh sterilized milk for 50 days. Now, with regards to how WFP support the government, we do it both ways. One at the national level for the technical part, and the other one is on the policy support and implementation of the program down there, particularly in the government of Bangsamoro Autonomous Region. In the past, we've been doing emergency school feeding, but because we transitioned to more developmental, so it's now more on capacity building. So the 4 main takeaways is, number one, definitely together and the same with the other countries in the world, there had been a problem with transportation because of the lockdown. And there are some limitations with regards to procuring some commodities because we cannot just simply buy it from anywhere else because even the land, air, and water transportation was also closed. And there was a complex financial management process that led actually to the delays of the procurement, particularly of the take-home ration. So as a matter of fact, when the class started in October, but not face-to-face, the distribution of these take-home rations actually was delayed for about 3 or 4 months. It depends on the region. At the same time, the program implementation in BARM was significantly delayed because of the centralized procurement of the rice. In 2019, we had a project, we piloted a project called Iron Fortified Rice to ensure that it can be done locally and we are looking at the feasibility of developing local iron fortified rice. It was good because it was a pilot, but then because of the COVID-19, there comes again the problem. So there's a lot of challenges with regards to the availability of the suppliers of the iron fortified rice and even the conduct of the monitoring of the nutritional status of children, because this is the criteria for admission. It's not blanket feeding. It's different from the other school feeding program in the region. And even the coverage was also a challenge. So they just rely on their data that was in 2019. And because COVID-19 was already here, it was actually aggravated by the calamities that happened towards the end of the year. 2 different typhoons affected the country that actually aggravated the situation. So we need to ensure the inclusiveness and the safety net program in the country. The other question is with regards to how WFP support the government, both in short term and long term. Well, first and foremost, we gathered ourselves together and we adjusted our country strategic plans. As a matter of fact, we are now in the process of midterm review, and we look at whether our country strategic plan is still important. I mean, in terms of its complementation with the government's purpose in mitigating the effect of COVID-19. The other one is we supported the government in doing the assessment and studies of COVID-19's impact on school feeding, particularly on food security and nutrition. And the other one is overcoming the identified challenges by providing technical assistance to the BARM region, particularly in redesigning their modified take-home ration, logistics, we provided them with trucks, and of course, improving or enhancing our partnership to ensure that those commodities are delivered to the different parts of the country. Now, for the last slide, for the short term, what we want is that we are advocating for a safe reopening of the schools and restore the access to school feeding as soon as possible. But as mentioned by our country director, the president is not really keen about reopening it very, very soon. For long term, we need to learn from the crisis. Definitely, it became actually a teacher for all of us. We need to build back equitable, quality school-based health and nutrition together with the other complementary activities, deworming, adolescent health, women empowerment, all of those things, school gardening, etc. And to build lasting and strategic partnership, because we believe that we cannot just simply do it all alone by ourselves. We need to look at the other NGOs and development partners to support us along the way. And the last one is, of course, a school feeding coalition, which we plan to meet the Department of Education Secretary and the rest of her team on Friday. So with that, thank you very much. And over to you, Carmen.
Thank you so much for that. And thank you, Brenda and Martin, for that explanation. It's interesting to understand really the challenges that governments are facing. And I just want to clarify here that, you know, the presentation that we just saw, the challenges that that were presented are really challenges that are being encountered by the government through its program, the difficulties of really pivoting to supporting children in a that are at home, that are no longer at school, is really bottlenecks all around, including, for example, government's financial procedures, government procurement procedures, and all of that. It sounds easier said than done when we think we need to provide take-home rations or alternative mechanisms. It's not as easy for governments to pivot. So actually, I'm very excited because our next speaker is from the government of Sri Lanka, Ms. Kamani Gunaratne. She is the Education Director of School Health and Nutrition for the Ministry of Education of Sri Lanka. And we've been talking a lot about governments, government policies, and their challenges on really what has happened during COVID and what is the government planning to do. So very much welcome, Ms. Kamani Gunaratne, to this webinar. Tell us a little bit about Sri Lanka's plans for the future. What are you seeing? What are your priorities moving forward? And also, if you are talking to other governments, and we have some in the audience here that are from some other countries, what recommendations do you have for them? Let me just let you know that you have about 10 minutes, I believe. Over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure for me to address this forum could you go to the first slide of mine? Yes, the next slide. This is the objectives of our program. I have given two questions. These are the questions. First one is to improve effectiveness and coverage of school feeding program in the coming based on the lessons learned from COVID-19. And the second one is to provide recommendations for other countries while collecting from other countries. Next, the first COVID patient was identified in Sri Lanka in March 2020. Throughout this year and last year, most of the days schools were closed during the pandemic. During this period, online education has carried on by the education ministry and the teachers, and government took much action to teach students by using various methods, using TV channels, YouTube channels, and various online methods also used. To improve effectiveness of several steps were taken in last year. Sri Lanka government mainly financed the school feeding program. And last year we provided take-home ration packs for all the beneficiaries of school feeding program. And next slide, please. Yes, the last year during the school closure, take-home ration program was implemented and it was mainly financed by the government. Standard ration pack was introduced with the advices given by health ministry, and this food pack was distributed among all the beneficiaries. It was taken much time to distribute since the schools are located in rural areas. That World Food Program also financially supported to this take-home ration. World Food Program covered 886 schools in four provinces in last year. Next. Yes. This is a hard period we ever met in our lives. So our little children felt that this take-home ration, which was given for them, is giving value to them. Some said that it was valuable, not the content, but it was a mental strength for them and their parents. Accordingly, to the survey done by the WFP and the Ministry of Education, 45% students were able to increase the portion size of meal once or twice a day. And 82 students were able to diversify the meal using this take-home ration. Children lost special foods because their parents didn't have any income during the pandemic. So 82 of the students said that they have diversified meal they had. While studying at home, THR helped them with additional energy, and it was both physically and mentally. Next. Yes. Sri Lanka is experiencing an escalation of COVID-19 positive from early May 2021, and lockdown situations was continued till the end of May, but still schools were closed. And to improve effectiveness and coverage of the school feeding program, several programs are planning. School meal program by the government, take-home ration programs by the government, WFP, and Save the Children, and Nutrica arts and essay competitions, the homegrown school feeding program. Next. Yes. THR is not ready to distribute. The current content is grams, rice noodles, soya meal, dal, low sugar plain biscuits in this THR in this year. Allocated funds has not been used due to school closure, and we have planned to spend it for this year, THR. 1.08 million students in 7,940 primary schools in rural areas are the beneficiaries. And those students are in vulnerable families, and they are in primary grades and in the age between 5 to 10 years. Next. In this year, WFP has supported for the THR program. They were given $200,000 financially to cover 41,000 primary age students. Their in-kind support is 189 metric ton canned fish to cover 230,000 primary age students in 5 districts. And the standard ration pack composition is also here. Maybe. Next slide. Save the Children organization is also joined with the government by distributing dal and salmon fish cans in this. Now it is functioning in distribution around the country, 886 schools around the country. Along with their food pack, they have prepared a cooking recipe for distribution. This year, Save the Children organization is planned to construct kitchens in 17 schools for cooking the school meal. Then next, the art and essay competition. It is also scheduled by the Ministry of Education and Nutrition Society also joined with us to schedule it. The art competition, the theme is respect food and minimize wastage. The essay competition, role of nutrition for the well-being of society. Those are the themes, and the objectives are to promote the use of safe and good quality food among school children by changing their dietary behaviors. While studying at home, children can enjoy with these activities during this pandemic. And it will cause to promote and inculcate healthy dietary behaviors among the children. Next, the homegrown school feeding program. This is the most important program, I think. The WFP has introduced it. And the last year it was activated in 10 schools in remote areas. In this year, 45 schools are selected and beneficiaries are 6,000 students and 45 schools. 90 caterers are the beneficiaries. The objective is to support small-scale farmers and school meal providers. Next. World Food Program supported the farmers and food suppliers to provide water tanks, water preparing, water pumping motors, tanks for poultry farms, tents for poultry, kitchen utensils for food suppliers. Those are the things done by the World Food Program the last year. And this year also, it is going to implement in the schools. Next, school homegrown school feeding program is a very important program for our country during this COVID situation. It helps to prevent malnutrition of our school children since the schools have been closed. And children also can help their parents with gardening and farming with this homegrown program. Finally, the recommendations. These are the recommendations from our part. The leadership should be taken by the government in this school feeding program, and multi-sectoral involvement is needed, especially the Ministry of Education, Ministry of Health, and work with other cooperation of State Ministry of Women's and Child Development and Cooperative Development Ministry, the other involvement we needed. And allocation is needed from national budget for this big program. And government needs the support of other organizations like WFP, Save the Children, and other local organizations also needed. Existing initiatives should be capitalized, and innovative ideas also accept for this program, and participatory action should be introduced like art competition. Those are the participatory action. And that's the all recommendations from us, and thank you all.
Thank you so much for that super interesting presentation of what has happened in Sri Lanka. Congratulations to the government for your leadership and your commitment to children's health and education, Ms. Gunaratne, and thank you very much for sharing with us a little bit about the situation, how the government has coped, and also very nice to know how many partners you have helping to address the challenges that you're facing. Let me now round up this panel by introducing Professor Donald Bundy, and a lot of you might know him if you have been in any of the events that have to do with school health and nutrition over the last 15 years. You probably know this man, a very good friend of WFP. He is a professor at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. He's also the director of the newly established School Health and Nutrition Research Consortium. So very much welcome, Don, to this panel. And I think we don't have slides for you. We'll just have a chat, you and I think, on really what does this mean for governments, for partners moving forward. We've heard from the Philippines, we've heard from Sri Lanka, we've also heard of the results of the OPM study. I think it resonates very well with some of the findings that you're working on together with agencies like WFP, UNICEF, FAO, and really the focus of the pandemic and the impact of the pandemic on children. And, you know, this is why we really felt that governments needed a platform and a boost and really come together to prioritize these issues during 2021 with the School Meals Coalition. So let me just give it over to you for now, Don. What are your thoughts initially looking at these presentations? What does this tell us about the moment that we're living in, about the priorities that we should have for how is this impacting school children?
Super, thanks a lot, Carmen, for that introduction. And it's a real pleasure to listen to this work led by the regional team. I think it's fantastic that they've had this real in-depth look at what's going on. And I feel that, John Aylieff's introduction actually said it all, frankly. We didn't know in January 2020 how well off we were. Those were the good days, right? We look back on that in this region, some of them, the most populous countries in the world were doing near universal school feeding. I mean, remarkable. And then suddenly everything crashed. Suddenly all the progress came to a shuddering halt. And what we started to see was that everything was lost. The education was lost, nutrition was lost, health was lost, all of those things that we had taken for granted through these school-based systems. I don't mean us. I don't think we ever took them for granted, but certainly governments took them for granted. Certainly the perception was that these weren't terribly important, terribly interesting areas, but suddenly they stopped. And there were these social consequences, which are absolutely dire. I mean, we heard again from the OPM report, but we've seen this in many parts of the world. The consequences for girls in particular of now no longer being in school, no longer schoolgirls. So let's get married. Early marriage, early employment, early pregnancies. Those girls are not going back to school. This is absolutely destructive. And then we heard, Brenda was emphasizing access to education. Many children, no access to education. She mentioned a figure of 4% access to online education in some parts of the Philippines. Lifelong consequences, prospects, for education damaged. So obviously there's been enormous efforts to try and respond to this, but we know that those efforts have real problems associated with them, that the standard tool, take-home rations, is really a household food security tool. It's not directly at these children. And we know that children that aren't that used to benefit, for example, from cash transfers, which made them go to school and more access to school, those children actually didn't learn any better. That learning is stimulated, learning and access is stimulated by in-school programs. So, big take-home message here is we shouldn't be closing schools. Closing schools is a disaster. It has terrible long-term consequences for our societies. And if we close them, we need to reopen them. And that's that's I think the very clear message. Back to you, Carmen.
Absolutely. And I think in many countries around the world are realizing in a way that closing schools should be the last resort. It should be the absolute last thing that you do. And I understand that a lot of the research that you've been doing also in the London School tell us that the costs of closing schools are much greater than the benefits of keeping children at home, even while the pandemic was unfolding, especially because children don't appear to be great spreaders of the virus and don't necessarily get infected as much as adults. So if we put that on the balance and the enormous social costs that we are right now seeing by this massive effect on school closures and by connection, the loss of these safety nets is astronomical compared to the benefits of that, correct?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And the thing is as well that I think the finance story is unfolding in an interesting way. The OPM study shows that many of the countries are continuing their investment in school feeding and nutrition. And although there's a fear of reduced investment in education, a lot of countries are actually now saying, we've finally realized why we should be doing this. We need to invest in the 8,000 days. We need to, this is a terrible failure for us. So many countries are in fact coming back in and saying, well, actually we now get it that when we invest in these kids, this isn't just feeding these kids, this is creating the next generation, the next level of human capital. It's creating a social safety net. It's investing in our agricultural system. And of course, the latest thing is job creation. We now recognize there's about 1,000 jobs for every 100,000 people fed. And so the countries are starting to pick up on the idea. So I mean, I have to say that the positive side of the COVID pandemic is that there's a real starting to be a larger recognition of the value of these systems. Mm-hmm. And that may help us moving forward. Obviously not all countries, and clearly we heard an example where the president was saying, well, I'm not going to reopen schools. We need to come back with some real evidence there, because the evidence that closing schools is beneficial to the epidemic is really very unclear, very unsupported.
So you're mentioning evidence, Don, and this is probably the last question for you before we go to the Q&A. But you know, this, we see it in the Q&A here, and the questions that we're getting from participants as well. There's a lot of questions from governments around, okay, so how do we do this? How much does this cost? How are these programs more cost effective? If governments have budgets for these programs, and now that they are reinvesting in many cases, and we saw in the OPM study, congratulating governments as well in maintaining their budgets for school meals programs around the world, that's a really good thing. What should governments do in terms of, if they have to make decisions, where do they put their money? How do they design these programs to really deliver the outcomes that we all want them to deliver? So I think you have a pretty good setup there in terms of helping governments with a better evidence. Can you tell us a little bit about the new research consortium?
Sure, indeed. So thanks for that. So and I hope you're going to tell us all a bit more about the coalition in the Q&A period. So there's a global coalition, which is member states getting behind the idea of school feeding, as well as integrated school health and nutrition, as a major new global initiative. And part of that push is they want better evidence. They want good evidence to support their work. And that's why, at the request of governments, we launched in May this research consortium. We had the governments from Finland, Peru, and France saying how important it was to do the research. We had WFP and Dubai Cares in the lead on in a partnership supporting the financing of this. But we also had extraordinary people like Michael Kremer, the Nobel Peace Laureate in economics the Nobel Peace Laureate is you guys, right? That's WFP. We should all be very pleased about that one. The Nobel Economics Laureate at that time was Michael Kremer, and he and senior economists from the World Bank and from IFAD we're all saying, yes, we absolutely need to better understand the dynamics of this. And the research consortium then has been set up as a global resource, very much a southern-focused global resource. So we're looking for partners in the countries we're talking with right now. Very much southern-focused, very much independent of its donors. Thank you, WFP, for being arm's length with us on all of this. And to focus on three key questions. One is the quality of the food involved in the program, to see these as nutrition programs, not as food programs. Secondly, to see how these programs address the learning crisis. I'm talking about the learning crisis before COVID. I'm talking about how do we improve the quality of learning for children as they go through the middle childhood and adolescence. And thirdly, back to your point, value for money. What is it that makes for a good program that's actually an investment in your nation's children? Let me finish by saying the one thing that all nations do universally is provide universal basic education. That's the one thing that all nations, whether they're right wing or left wing, however they're politically positioned, see as worth doing. And we now need to see that if we're going to invest in learning, we need to invest in the learner at the same time. And that's what all of us do in our school health and school feeding work.
Thank you so much for that. And really, thank you for being one of the main partners in this growing coalition of partners. And academia is a key stakeholder in helping us and governments really answer a lot of the questions that we have. These are complex operations. They're not simple programs. And we know that governments are really anxious to receive a lot of support and evidence to make their decisions. So let us go a little bit now to a Q&A session. We'll do a bit of a ping pong here, just looking at some of the questions that are coming up in the chat. And I can see that there's some questions around the take-home ration element of what has happened during the pandemic. How has this happened? But also specifically, what might we know of the gender dimensions of these initiatives? And so this is the third question we have here on the Q&A. And Kamani Gunaratne would like to answer this question. So I'm happy to give the floor over to you. Give us a little bit of a breakdown of what do you see are the gender differentials, let's say, or the impact of this, but also on school, on take-home rations. Over to you.
Yes, I think in Sri Lanka, the gender equality is wanted, and we have to make the arrangements for the gender perspective. That is my idea about that. And next year, we would like to implement it, the gender equality for the THR and the food meal program. Okay.
So can you talk a little bit about what that means? Is that you will specifically target girls?
Yes, we have the data about the gender, but still we didn't think about it, and we next year, yeah, we would like to implement it, the gender, consider it gender.
I see. Okay. So really putting in a gender perspective to your program, understanding what the data is telling you to understand what more can you do for girls and for boys, how this is impacting them.
Yes, I think this with this COVID situation, girls need, boys need more food than the girls. So mm-hmm. we have to think about that. It's a new thing for us, and we mm-hmm. still we think about the gender situation, but now we have to implement it.
Understood. Yes, I mean, that is definitely a priority, I would say, both from the study that we just heard from, but also the evidence that we're having worldwide is really looking at what are the consequences for girls and boys, and how are school closures, but also the loss of these safety nets, and what governments can do to make sure that we we are analyzing that and responding appropriately. There's another question here on the Q&A, which is also about practical examples of how countries have adapted their programs in especially in poor areas, or countries come or families with poor living in poverty. So let me see, Brenda, from your experience, you were mentioning you had just come from Sri Lanka, now you're in the Philippines. Do you have a little bit of reflections on how you see governments have reacted during the pandemic? What are some of the strategies that they have put in place? What is your outlook right now on what's happening?
Thank you. Well, I mean, certainly we know that, as Dawn and others were saying, and John, the social safety nets are critical. And so we certainly saw here in the Philippines, but we also saw that when I was in Sri Lanka, that the major government social safety net programs did seek to gear up to provide some extra assistance to families. But what I observed in both countries is that there wasn't, a meeting of the two minds, in the sense that the targeting, you know, children out of school or the social safety net programs that are catering to poor families, the targeting perhaps wasn't as linked up as one would like. And so it was, let's say the resources were there, but to really know who was falling through the net, I don't think we have the evidence for that. So these are the kinds of things that our work here in the Philippines on the with the Global School Feeding Coalition, and as Martin said, we're having meetings tomorrow. These are the kinds of gaps that we hope to be able to raise with the Department of Education, with the other players, is on targeting.
Yeah, and that's a really important point, because I think it also reinforces something that Maham was saying, but also Dawn, in the sense that even though governments have, with the help of WFP and UNICEF and other partners like FAO and others, NGOs, Save the Children, very important actors. So nobody disputes that there's been an enormous effort to support children throughout this crisis. The problem is that we still have a lot of children that are falling through the cracks. We don't even know where they are. We don't even know who they are, because as you're saying, sometimes we put in place these emergency safety nets, but there are children that are being left out. Also because it exacerbates inequalities. We have children that are not receiving the meals anymore, they're not connected to online learning and don't have access to digital means. They might already be behind in terms of health and nutrition and other things. So we are kind of looking at this kind of exacerbating inequality situation with, I would say, quite a problem in terms of tracking and understanding who they are. Whereas before, when schools are open and when we have access to these kids, at least we know, you know, at least we have this information that is running and that governments can use to make decisions on. So that's a pretty difficult thing. Brenda, while we're with you, and maybe this is a question to jump from you to Dawn as well, we have another question on finance. And of course, this is a really, probably the biggest bottleneck, the biggest question that we always have, both from governments, from implementing partners. Everybody wants to know, how do we afford these programs? And in your experience, and you've spent your career in helping governments figure this out, what are some of your reflections around finance, and how can governments really afford these programs? I know that you've been supporting governments with very innovative approaches here. And I would say also with Dawn, as after you answer, curious to know, Dawn, what more can we do from the coalition, the research consortium, the financing task force that is also in coordination with you working on this topic? First, let's hear from Brenda some reflections from the field.
Oh gosh, well, I always find that governments and the, especially the ministries or departments of education, are always crying for more. They know they need to do more. They want to have greater coverage, but they need to have their voices heard, and they want to be more listened to. And so a lot of this is trying to make the case to the ministries of planning, the ministries of finance, you know, the higher decision makers, to really understand the cost of malnutrition and the cost of hunger and the cost of losing those children, as we were discussing today on the GDP, et cetera. So presenting it in that way. And I think at the same time, looking at programs like homegrown school meals, we're doing this now in the Bangsamoro, Mindanao area, looking at government purchasing programs where they can support small-scale farmers, and they may not have thought about hooking that up to their social safety nets and getting a double win, or introducing iron fortified rice, as we're also doing, which is again another important initiative here. There's a law in the country and a bill to fortify rice, and then trying to make a connection between that and the school meals program. So looking at maybe better interconnections of government programs and social services as well. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a really good point in the sense of how can governments even connect their policies and connect their initiatives as well. I can see your hand up, Maham, and maybe there's a couple of things that are coming up in the Q&A that maybe between you and Don we can have a final conversation around this, which is one on, you know, what are the impacts of school closures on health and nutrition outcomes of children, and I know that this is an area that we're still very much trying to figure out. And then, of course, the remnants of this financing conversation. So let's start with Don, and maybe Maham, we can finish with you.
Yeah. Okay. That's great. These are great, interesting questions. I noticed what several of them are being posed by Gobinath, my colleague at the MS Swaminathan Research Foundation in Chennai, and I look forward to coming over to join your very prestigious conference later this year on this topic. You know, one of the things that immediately came to my mind when we were talking about targeting food was actually a conversation I had here in the UK recently, that the groups that have been feeding, providing interim feeding programs, mitigation programs in the UK, notoriously have very varied ways of doing this. And, you know, we had a great conversation about why this is. So each local government, in fact, is deciding what system is best for it, depending on its on the composition of its folks. And so, for example, I was very surprised, you know, we have voucher, there are voucher programs. There are programs where the schools continue to provide food, children have to go to the school and get fed. And then there are other programs where you actually take food parcels home, something like the take-home ration. That last kind of program is one that's used because the social workers get to go to the home with the food. They get to go and actually monitor what's going on in the home. It comes exactly to the point that Brenda, you and Carmen were both making, that knowing, actually being in contact and thinking about targeting in terms of identifying those most at need really needs a different and more active process. And I'm, one of the reasons I'm raising the UK as an example, those of you know me know I hardly ever do that, but I do that in this case because for the first time we have something that's hurting the rich countries just in the same sorts of ways as it's hurting the less resourced countries. And that, you know, it's fascinating to see President Macron of France sending a tweet saying France wants to be part of this global coalition because this is a problem for France just as much as it's an international problem. And that's true of the, I could tell you stories about the US in exactly the same way, that these are problems which now require new thinking around financing. And that, again, part of what the consortium is doing, we're working in particular with the Global Education Forum Task Force for Finance to try and resolve some of these issues. Carmen.
Thank you so much, Don, for that. We are over time, but I do want to make sure that we get our last speaker in for some final thoughts, Maham, on what you've heard, but also how that resonates back to the report that you presented in a couple of minutes. Over to you.
Yeah, thanks, everyone. I think the key, for me, the key finding and the key message that I would like to convey to everyone is that there is an interim period between now and when the schools will reopen. And as we continue to advocate for the reopening of schools, we cannot forget that this interim period could be quite long. And therefore, any efforts that are made then to address the suspension of school feeding must now be smarter. And we need to sort of get out of this emergency response mode and really think about what this interim period should look like. And so some very quick fixes. So on the gender issue, you know, it's impossible to monitor what goes on within a household during a pandemic and how the rations are being distributed and how, what the dietary practices are. But you could, for instance, include sanitary pads, yeah, in the take-home rations. You could include deworming pills. On financing, I think the size of the envelope is important, but also what's important is the underlying public financial management rules. So what we saw in the last year, for example, was that in countries which had budgets, in Nepal, for example, or in the Barm region, they had budgets for school feeding, but they couldn't do take-home rations because the rules meant that you could only distribute food in schools. And so if anything else, you had to get an approval for budgetary allocation from the parliament, right? So it's not just, there are lots of these operational details that I think could be focused on in this interim period to make it less harmful and, yeah, more effective. That's it.
Thank you so much for those insights to all of you. And we're a little bit over time, but I on purpose made sure that we could get all of your insights, which I think are very rich for participants. I just want to close by, first of all, saying that the messages that were reiterated today are very, very important. It's clear that the COVID crisis has had a huge impact on children, particularly through this phenomenon of school closures. We understand that governments need to take the measures that they consider appropriate for school openings, but one of the major messages is that that should happen as soon as it's safely possible, and not 1 minute longer, because the longer children stay out of school, the less likely they are to return, the more likely they are to, you know, never come back to school and never benefit from that education. But as we just heard, we also have a bit of a moment now where we need to be smarter. We need to be understanding what can we do to ensure that these children are not falling behind and falling through the cracks. Lots of really interesting insights. I'm just gonna close by saying we've been talking a lot about the coalition. And for those of you listening here, you might be wondering, what is this coalition? You can contact me, you can contact colleagues in WFP, but you can also contact colleagues in FAO and other UN agencies that are collaborating in this massive effort. I am very happy to say we have now 40 countries that have signed up to the coalition. This is government-led, and this is really about leaders deciding that this is an imperative this year to get us out of the pandemic, but also to move us towards the 2030 Sustainable Development Goals. We also have UN agencies that are joining, NGOs, the private sector, academia, represented here, for example, by Professor Bundy and others, that have all decided that this has been an issue that has been neglected for far too long. We have, in a way, watched over decades how these programs can be transformational, and it is really time to scale them up. It is time to improve their quality. It is time to really put in place platforms that can transform entire communities, not just children themselves, their parents, the farmers that are around, the women that can get employment around these programs. They are really, could be engines to take us out of this pandemic and really onto a new path towards development. So that's the idea of the coalition. The organizations that wish to understand more about it, as I mentioned, can contact us. This is being led by governments such as Finland, France, that was mentioned already, Senegal, Rwanda, Egypt, Guatemala, Honduras. I can go on and on and on. And the idea is that this is a long-term objective. We are really putting in place not only a call to action and a political commitment by leaders in the September Food System Summit, but also initiatives that are going to support governments to achieve these goals. Among them, of course, are the research consortium that Professor Bundy spoke about, but others, including a peer-to-peer network that is being set up to make sure that governments can exchange their experiences and can learn from each other, a financing task force that hopefully will tackle some of this tricky funding conversation and financing issues that we're seeing all around. And then also, of course, tracking and monitoring. How are we doing with these objectives? And a very successful initiative that's starting on advocacy and making sure that these issues are top and center of the development discussions globally. I just end by saying we're very happy that the G20 met yesterday and adopted a declaration in Madeira, which specifically supports the launch and the building of this coalition as a priority for food security and food systems worldwide. So we're building a movement, and we really do invite all of you to join it's supported by WFP, but it is not led by WFP. It is led by government and by all of the partners that support government. But let me just thank you all for participating. I hope it has been an interesting session. And thank you to our panelists and to our participants for their insights and for their information today. I think there's a survey that you're being asked to fill out after the webinar that will really help to make these kinds of events better in the future. Thank you all for joining and have a good rest of your day. Bye-bye.